Hey guys, welcome to the final episode of our video series on Marmaduke's Mansion, the 120-gallon custom bearded dragon terrarium. This is part two of the build videos, where we'll be showing you how we designed and built the landscaping elements of the terrarium. First, if you haven't seen the overview video yet, please click the link above to check out all the upgrades we've made since the previous tank, and to watch Marmaduke ride a skateboard. If you've made it all the way to this video, you've probably already seen part one of the build series, where we showed you how we fabricated the structure of the metal frame and internal components for heating and lighting. If you haven't seen it yet, click the link at the top of this video. Now, in part two, we show you how we finished out all these elements to provide a naturalistic landscape for Marmaduke to enjoy. This phase mainly consisted of using spray foam to build the base of the landscaping and then carving it to shape, then covering it with chicken wire as a support structure for the layer of pigmented stucco laid on top. Okay, let's get to it. In part one, I showed you this first pencil drawing that was really the starting point for this whole project. Now that it was time to complete the rest of the landscaping features, I often kept this drawing nearby just to help me remember how I wanted things to be laid out. For example, what types of climbing structures I'd need to connect the platforms, and where a good location might be for, you know, a plant, say, on the back wall. Here's what the shelves looked like at the end of the last phase, with those metal rods sticking out the top to help transfer heat across the shelf. First thing to do now was to use some insulation spray foam to build up the top surface of the shelf to create forms that I could carve into interesting shapes. If you've seen my original tank build video, and click the link at the top if you haven't, you know that I really love this spray foam stuff. Here are the three shelves together, each with some spray foam added on top, and then placed outside to cure for several days. And here's how the shelves look with a test fit inside the tank. At this point, I had already carved the top and bottom shelves, but you can see that the middle shelf is still quite fluffy and hasn't been carved at all yet. Also here you can see how we've taken those upright metal rods and bent them down across the top surface of the shelves. This helps to transfer the heat evenly across the shelf rather than just heating up a single spot. This will help to keep the tank heated more evenly and should theoretically require less energy to heat the tank since the heat will be retained within more surfaces in the tank. To cover up this spray foam, I decided to use stucco, which is a masonry product similar to concrete. As I've mentioned before, we switched from the silicone that we used in the previous build because we wanted a more durable, hard material that would hold up for 10 or 15 years of Marmaduke climbing and scratching all over it. But stucco also presents another set of challenges. It's a much heavier material, and it needs to be applied at least 3/8 of an inch thick in order to maintain its integrity and not crumble. And so because the stucco is quite heavy and needs to be applied thick, It really needs an underlying mesh structure to give the stucco something to grab onto. And chicken wire actually works great for this. It helps prevent the stucco from sliding down as it cures, and it also makes sure the stucco will stick together and not crumble after years of use. It's sort of like how rebar is put in place before cement is poured for, say, a building's foundation, but on a smaller scale. So I've never really used these materials before, so I really wanted to make a small practice piece. I took some pieces of foam and glued them to this small plank of wood, then attached the chicken wire to the wood using wood screws and washers. And we've also got these little spacers underneath the mesh to make sure that we achieve that minimum required thickness of stucco. What these are actually made out of is an old crappy garden hose that we just had laying around the yard, so we just sliced the hose into these little discs. I mixed up a small batch of stucco, and then tried out applying it to the chicken wire covered wood using this trowel. I clamped the wood up at an angle in a vise to see if the mixture was thick enough to stay in place or if it would slide down with gravity. But it seemed to stay in place well enough. I also wanted to try out embedding some naturalistic materials into the stucco, just like I had done with the previous tank using silicone. I had some of this leftover bark blend that I soaked in water for a few minutes, just thinking that wet bark would probably stick better to the wet stucco. Then I just poked it into the stucco, trying to make sure it had good contact. I also did the same with the leftover pebbles from the previous tank build. I just rinsed them off to remove any grit, and then pressed the wet pebbles into the stucco. This is how it looked after a couple days of curing. You can see that the plain stucco without pigment is a kind of ugly gray color. So this test really helped us decide that we wanted to add some pigment into the stucco for the real thing. I also wanted to see how well the bark and pebbles had adhered, so I poked and prodded at them to see how much force it would take to pull them off. Okay, with lessons learned from this test, I decided to start stuccoing the shelves. At this point, I had already carved the foam and covered it with chicken wire and those slices of garden hose for spacers. This was actually the most difficult part of the landscaping phase. It nearly took forever to cut and bend and twist the chicken wire into just the right shapes to cover up the foam. I also wanted some way that I could mount all the plastic plants to these shelves, so I carved out some small pockets in the foam to hold these longer pieces of cut up tubing, which would kind of serve as miniature plant vases for the plants later. Now it's time to mix up a big batch of stucco. The dull gray color is not very pleasing to the eye, so we decided to incorporate some pigment. Luckily, since cement and stucco share a lot of the same components, these same dyes can be used for both products. So we bought three different colors that we would prepare separately and then blend together during application. To prepare the pigment, it's simply mixed with water that will be used to hydrate the stucco. I think that the way that the dye looks when it's dropped into the water looks so cool. here again is how that shelf looked right before adding the stucco. Here is one of the shelves halfway through. Sorry you didn't get much video of the process. My hands were covered in stucco and it was really messy. To apply this, I basically just picked up handfuls of stucco and smooshed them down into the chicken wire. I alternated the colors as I added them and just blended them together with my fingers. Okay, so remember those concealed heat boxes that we made to tuck up underneath the shelves and keep the tank warm? Well, we decided we couldn't just leave the metal bare like that, so we decided to use the same chicken wire and stucco method on the heat boxes as well. Now, as you recall, we attached chicken wire to the wooden shelves using screws. But we had to come up with another way to give that chicken wire something to hold on to. What we ended up doing was welding a bunch of metal wires sticking out the sides of the heat boxes. Does this remind you of anything? Anyway, so the chicken wire was then wrapped around the heat box with these metal spikes poking through the holes. And then those metal spikes were bent over on top of the chicken wire. It kind of looks like a mess, but remember that you wouldn't see any of this in the end, and these interwoven metal elements are what will give the stucco something to hold onto so it doesn't just slide off the sheet metal. Here you can see we've also epoxied a piece of metal window screen to seal off the bottom of the heat box. Alright, so this somewhat hideous looking contraption is now ready to be covered up with more pigmented stucco, hydrated bark, and pebbles. I used a trowel to apply the stucco onto the heat box, and then used my hands to fill in the gaps and compress it together. I used a fork and my fingers to try to give it some texture. After allowing the stucco to cure for several days, the color is much lighter. I did add the brown pigment to this batch, but the final color was not nearly as brown as I had hoped. So to get these to a color that I thought maybe would blend in a little better with the background, I used a little bit of black and green spray paint on the cured stucco. Here's a comparison of one heat box with spray paint and one without. After completing these initial pieces, I was starting to get a better feel of how I wanted all the elements to fit together in the tank. I knew I wanted a big branch in the center to connect the platform so that Marmaduke could climb across from one to the next. So I scored this really heavy and really expensive piece of spiderwood from our local aquarium supply shop. In order to secure it in place, we had to drill some holes into the back of the spiderwood and then epoxy some bolts into those holes. Then we could simply push those bolts through corresponding holes that we'd drill in the back panel and put some washers and nuts on the back side of the tank to hold it all together. With the large spiderwood in place, I could start putting the other elements into the tank to see how much space they would take up. Here are the three shelves, all stuccoed up and having cured for several days. I started placing some of the plastic plants into those pieces of tubing that I'd embedded into the shelves, and also placing various logs and hammocks around to see how things might be arranged. This bottom level here is where the original glass tank would be situated when the whole thing's put together. With this rough layout, I was able to trace the outlines of the shelves and the other major elements with a yellow pencil, so I knew where they'd be situated against the background. This basically tells me where I do not want to be adding any textural elements on the background. Then I used spray foam, again, my favorite spray foam, to start building up some structures on the background outside of those boundaries. Now with this big blob of foam here, I wanted to try to add onto the spiderwood structure so that it might look like it's coming off of a larger trunk perhaps and not just sticking straight out of the background. Another element we really wanted to add into the background is these old polypore mushrooms. These are real, actual mushrooms that we collected in the wild many years ago. Polypore mushrooms are also known as shelf mushrooms, as they typically grow kind of protruding off the side of a tree trunk. They are super dense and hard when dry, almost like wood, which means they are easy to preserve and keep around the house. This species of mushroom is called Ganoderma aplanatum, which is otherwise known as the artist's conch. It has a white surface on the underside that you can scratch with a sharp stick to draw patterns on it, hence the name artist conch. This is the edge of the mushroom that was originally attached to the tree. We sanded it down here to get a flat edge that we could attach to the back of the tank. You can see it really looks like wood inside. And this last one here, I'm actually not totally sure what species it is. It has these neat purple veins on the top that I've never seen before. If you think you know what mushroom this is, post it in the comments below. Alright, so here's the back of the tank after curing and carving the spray foam that I had added. At this point, I could do a test fit with the three shelves and the three polypore mushrooms put in their intended locations to see if everything would fit. And Marmaduke's here testing it out as well. Once we made sure that the foam was carved out such that everything would fit in place, we went ahead and drilled out some holes in the back panel to attach those polypores. Just like we did with the large spiderwood in the center, we drilled holes into the edges of the mushrooms and epoxied bolts into those holes that would then go through the back panel. The next step was to prep the foam on the background for stucco. Just like I'd done with the shelves earlier, I cut and bent pieces of chicken wire to fit the curves of the foam, then secured it in place with screws through the plywood, and used some old garden hose slices to create the necessary gap. I also cut out some more pockets here for pieces of tubing that would, again, kind of serve as plant vases to hold the plastic plants later. And one last test fit to make sure that the mushrooms still fit. I realized once taking the tank outside in the sun that I had actually scratched up quite a lot of the black paint on the plywood while wrangling that sharp chicken wire into place. So I decided to apply another coat of spray paint just to touch it up prior to adding the stucco. I taped off the edges of the plexiglass to keep those paint free, but didn't bother doing the same around the foam since you'd never actually see this foam after the stucco was applied. So I made up some fresh batches of pigmented stucco and just started smooshing it into place on top of the chicken wire with my hands. This is that area that sits right beneath the large spiderwood, which I intended to look like branches and a tree trunk continuing from that spiderwood. So I mixed the colors and just tried to give it some texture to make it look like tree bark. Not bad. This is how the rest of it looked after I finished up the stucco. You can see I've chosen to primarily use the dark charcoal color for the rest of the design, as I thought that would blend nicely with the black plywood. I've just added some of the lighter brown colors for highlights and pops of color. I also smooshed in some pebbles in places to give it more texture. Here it is again, after a day or two of curing. Despite me trying to be as neat as possible during stucco application and wiping as much of the water from the plywood as I could, you can really see once it's dried that there's still a sort of halo of stucco residue around all the edges. Now, rather than trying to scrub it all off, I decided to just cover it up with one more coat of spray paint. I taped around the edges of the stucco so that I wouldn't get any paint on the stucco itself, just the plywood around it. And here's how it looked after spray painting again. Okay, at this point, all of the construction and interior design is finally done. Remember how in part one, we discussed that we'd actually have to cut the legs off in order to maneuver this addition on top of the old tank? We showed you how it's too tall to actually be able to lift it high enough to just slide it down on top of the tank, because the ceiling is in the way. Well, now was the time to take the plunge and finally cut the legs off using a portable bandsaw. And now that the legs were finally cut off, it was crunch time to get Marmaduke into his new home. Did need to make one last modification to the original tank that would be sitting at the bottom. Remember from before that we had built a shelf that would sit right here on the left side of the tank, and that there would be a heat box tucked underneath. So I actually had to cut out all this old spray foam and silicone in order to create space to accommodate those new items. It actually peeled off the glass a lot more easily than I expected, which was nice. Here's how it looked when I finished removing all that foam from this corner and then carving the edges smooth again. Really all I did was slather the glass and exposed foam in the corner with a fresh layer of silicone and pressed in a layer of coconut coir fiber. The heat box would just be sitting right in front of it and you'd never really see what was behind. Before Marmaduke could actually move in, there was one other small element that I wanted to make for the tank. I'd actually been working on this throughout the project, so at this point it was all done, but I do want to show you how I made these cute little mushrooms out of wooden sticks, spray foam, and silicone. This is just an old branch that I found out in the yard that I scrubbed clean and boiled in water for a bit to kill any mold or bacteria on it. Then cut up into these short pieces that would kind of serve as the stems of my mushrooms. Then I made a cardboard platform to hold the sticks upright while I was working on them, with holes cut in the cardboard to hold each piece. I sprayed blobs of spray foam onto the top of each stick to form the cap of each mushroom. This was actually a pretty tricky business, as the sticks don't give much surface area for the foam to grab onto, so the foam tended to sag and fall right off. I had to try a few times to get it to stay. After curing and carving, it was time to decorate and turn these into cute little mushrooms. I wanted to use my gold standard coconut coir for these, but I didn't want just plain brown. It comes in a compressed block like this, and it has to be soaked in water to loosen the fibers. So, to get some color, I just added some old food coloring dye that I found in the kitchen to that water. I thought it would be an easy way to make colored coir, and it actually worked out pretty well. After drying out the coir, I brought together all my materials. Pebbles, bark, silicone, fake plastic moss, and 3 bags of dried coir. First, I slathered the carved foam mushroom cap with silicone. Then, I just pressed the various materials into the sticky silicone. Each mushroom got its own little pattern or design. My hands were a sticky mess while I was doing this, so I only got to take this video afterwards. After 4 long months, all the pieces of the tank are finally finished. Now it's time to assemble everything together and let Marmaduke move in. At last, the protective film on the plexiglass could ever so satisfyingly be peeled off. We'd kept these films on until the last second to protect the plexi from paint, stucco, and scratches. The heat boxes were assembled with the ceramic heat emitter, heat dome, cord protector, and screen. The lower heat box was then bolted to the underside of the lower shelf. Ever so gently, the shelf and heat box contraption was then lowered into its final resting place inside the tank. See how the heat box tucks nicely into that back left corner where I'd carved out the old foam earlier? Then we peeled off the outside protective films. Installed the spiderwood and polypore mushrooms through the bolt holes in the back panel, and we placed the other 2 shelves on their brackets and slid the upper heat box onto the hidden rails. At this point, all the major elements are in place, so there's nothing left to do except put all the plants, mushrooms, hammocks, and logs into place. And thus we conclude the Marmaduke's Mansion video series. We hope that you enjoyed watching and maybe even learned something that you might use when building your own reptile terrarium. Be sure to comment below and let us know what you think of this design. And stay tuned for more exciting videos of Marmaduke coming soon.